Hare Krishna. Yashoda here from West Coast Yoga. Welcome to morning class. Today we're studying Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, chapter number one, text number one, which reads as follows. Janmadiyasyata nyavad itaratash charatesvabhimanaj svarat tene brahma ridhayadi kavaye vuyanti yatsurayaha tejo vadi mridang yata vinimayo yatra tri saro mrisha damna svena sada nirasta kahukang satyang parandimahi. Translation. O my Lord, Sri Krishna, O son of Vasudev, O all-pervading personality of Godhead, I offer my respectful obeisances unto you. I meditate upon Lord Sri Krishna because he is the absolute truth and the primeval cause of all causes of the creation, sustenance, and destruction of the manifold universes. He is directly and indirectly conscious of all manifestations, and he is independent because there is no other cause beyond him. It is he only who first imparted the Vedic knowledge unto the heart of Brahmaji, the original living being. By him even the great sages and demigods are placed into illusion. As one is bewildered by illusory representations of water seen in fire, or land seen on water. Only because of him do the material universes, temporarily manifested by the reactions of the three modes of nature, appear factual, although they are unreal. I therefore meditate upon him, Lord Sri Krishna, who is eternally existent in the transcendental abode, which is forever free from the illusory representations of the material world. I meditate upon him, for he is the absolute truth. So we're going to read a few paragraphs of Srila Prabhupada's purport, which is quite lengthy, but we'll read a few paragraphs for good measure. Srila Prabhupada's purport. Obeisances unto the personality of Godhead Vasudev directly indicate Lord Sri Krishna, who is the divine son of Vasudev and Devaki. This fact will be more explicitly explained in the text of this work. Sri Vyasadeva asserts herein that Lord Sri Krishna is the original personality of Godhead, and all others are his direct or indirect plenary portions or portions of the portion. Srila Jiva Goswami has even more explicitly explained the subject matter in his Krishna Sandarbha. And Brahma, the original living being, has explained the subject of Sri Krishna substantially and his treasure treatise named Brahma Samhita. In an Upanishad in the Samaveda, it is also stated that Lord Sri Krishna is the divine son of Devaki. Therefore, in this prayer, the first proposition holds that Lord Sri Krishna is the primeval Lord, and if any transcendental nomenclature is to be understood as belonging to the absolute personality of Godhead, it must be the name indicated by the word Krishna, which means the all-attractive. In Bhagavad Gita, in many places, the Lord asserts himself to be the original personality of Godhead. And this is confirmed by Arjuna, and also by great sages like Narada, Vyas, and many others. In the Padma Purana, it is also stated that out of the innumerable names of the Lord, the name of Krishna is the principal one. Vasudeva indicates the plenary portion of the personality of Godhead, and all the different forms of the Lord, being identical with Vasudev, are indicated in this text. The name Vasudev particularly indicates the divine son of Vasudev and Devaki. Sri Krishna is always meditated upon by the Paramahansas, who are the perfected ones among those in the renounced order of life. Om Gyan Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Jena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Mukham Kuruti Vachalam Pangun Longay Tigidim Yat Kripa Tamaham Bande Shigurun Tina Tarinam. Srila Prabhupada explains that the Srimad Bhagavatam is the natural commentary on Vedanta Sutra. Vedanta Sutra appears earlier in the writings of Vyasadeva as an exposition on the Absolute Truth. However, it focuses greatly on the impersonal Brahman. Different sages indicate the absolute truth according to their realization. Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavan iti Shabdyate. However, Krishna's two Bhagavans, Vayam, he's the last word and the absolute truth. And after Vyasadeva compiled the Vedanta Sutra, he was feeling somewhat despondent. And there was a kind of, let's say, a void. He was feeling a void. He is, after all, the empowered agent of the Lord, a Shaktivesh avatar. So he has a very specific mission to accomplish during his time on earth. So while Vyasadeva was feeling this void, his spiritual master Narada Muni very kindly appeared on the spot, way up there in the Himalayan mountains. And he inquired from his disciple, "My dear Prabhu, are you happy identifying with the mind or the body as objects of self-realization?" He says, "Why have you given so many recommendations in the Vedas, you know, Samaveda, Atharvaveda, Rigveda, that indicate the heavenly planets or even yogic mystic perfections as objects of the yogic path, as objects of perfection?" And Narada explained very nicely that Vyasadeva had not delineated or described Krishna's pastimes. In other words, although he has compiled nice literature in the form of the Mahabharata, it's time to really focus on the objective for the people of the Kali Yuga. Because in the age of Kali, people are Manda, Sumanda, Matayo, Manda Bhagya, Ipahadrita. In the age of Kali, humans are lazy, quarrelsome, misguided, always disturbed. We have no such qualification to enter into the flowery language of the Vedas or the high philosophy of the Vedanta. We need a form of meditation that's very easy, ABC, and where there's no room for misinterpretation. And so Narada told Vyasadeva in very clear terms, "It's time for you to explain Lord Sri Krishna, his qualities, his activities, more directly." And so now we have Srimad Bhagavatam as the direct end result. It's said that the earthly region that we reside in is characterized by the mode of passion. First and foremost, there is a cloud in the spiritual world. Believe it or not, the spiritual world is a luminous realm full of Vaikuntha planets. But sometimes a cloud appears in the spiritual world. And this portion occupies one quarter of that realm. Within that cloudy region, you've got the unmanifest material energy, the Mahat Tattva. And Lord Vishnu enters that place. And he exists in what's called the Karana Ocean, the causal ocean. And from that primordial stage, the material world is gradually generated through different expansions of Vishnu and his energy. So the entire cloudy existence of the material expanse is largely characterized by the mode of passion. And we are living in that realm. Furthermore, in the entire material world, Bhur Bhuva Sva, there is a middle region, Bhumandala, that is particularly influenced by the mode of passion. And if you go to Bhumandala, there is a species called human species where the mode of passion is very prominent. And then in the entire human species, there's a lifestyle called householder life, Grihastha, very passionate. And there's a place that householders live, the city. The city is very passionate. So in this way, passion, 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 tenfold manifested in the mature world. It's no wonder that we're so much influenced. And we find often Lord Krishna, he likes to incarnate. You know, he knows the mode of passion is extremely prominent in the material world and in the human species. So he particularly incarnates among these passionate people, these administrators. And originally, in recent history, Krishna incarnated in what's known as the Sun Dynasty. That dynasty is explained in the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna describes the previous kings. He said, "Formerly I explained the science to the sun god, Vivasvan." Yeah. Sun means there's a planet, there's a person, their activities. And so the predominating personality and ruler of the sun planet is named Vivisvan. And these personalities cycle out in a regular rotation, perhaps 12 in a day of Brahma, something along those lines, the same as Manu, the same as Indra. So the Lord previously appeared on the sun planet to explain Bhagavad Gita, and Vishwanath Chakravarti very nicely explains in his commentary on the Gita, Arjuna was also present on the sun planet when Krishna spoke, but he was there in a different embodiment. So because Arjuna changed his body, he could not remember that previous speaking of the Bhagavad Gita, but Krishna, whose body does not change, could remember. So Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita on the sun planet many, many millions of years ago. Following that, in succession, the sun god spoke the Gita to his son. The sun god has 10 sons, the eldest of whom is named Sahadev, or he's also commonly known as Vaivasvata. Vaivasvata means son of Vivisvan. This Vaivasvata is a very special case because sometimes Krishna likes to recycle his devotees in different incarnations. So Vaivasvata is very famous. We read about him elsewhere in the Bhagavatam. In his former life, he was a great sage named Satyavrata, and it was he to whom the Lord appeared in his form as the fish incarnation, Matsya. So it was Vaivasvata's responsibility to gather the entire human population and animal population and place them on a boat, you know, Noah's Ark scenario. And then he also gathered the great sages. They had the Vedas in their hearts. And there was a great inundation that covered the world. And so Lord Matsya, he used the great serpent, Vasuki, and the Lord has a horn on his head. So using the serpent as a rope, they tied the boat to the Lord's horn, and all the sages and the different animals and Satyavrata Muni traveled inside the waters of devastation for many, many years, and in this way they preserved the Vedas. So this great personality, Vaivasvata, is a reincarnation of that Satyavrata Muni. So it's very significant. And then Satyavrata, in his next life as Vaivasvata, he had his children. He spoke the Gita to his son, Ikshvaku. Ikshvaku became the ruler of Earth Realm. So he spoke to his son. And in this way, the knowledge was received through disciplic succession for many hundreds and thousands of years. Lord Ramchandra would later appear in that dynasty, and he was the recipient of the knowledge. The information was still current as of our recent Treta Yuga, so a few million years ago. However, the influence of time is that it degrades all things, and so the knowledge was lost. And so Krishna, having previously appeared in the Sun Dynasty, now he comes in what's called the Lunar Dynasty. That's the dynasty that Yadu appeared in, that's the dynasty that Pandu appeared in, the Kauravas, the Pandavas, Krishna himself, Devaki, Ugrasena. These are all participants in the Moon Dynasty. So Krishna says, the knowledge was lost, now I've come again in this dynasty to repeat it to you, and it will be passed on in succession. Arjuna's son was named Abhimanyu. Abhimanyu's son was named Parikshit. Parikshit's son was named Janmejaya. So in this way, the knowledge continued to pass down. Unfortunately, the knowledge was also lost in the Lunar Dynasty. Lord Chaitanya came back to reintroduce the information, and now he's distributing it very widely. In this incarnation, the Lord comes in a Brahmin family as the son of Mother Shachi. So he's made a special concession. The knowledge is more accessible. So thank you for your kind attention. See you for class next time.